Hello, everyone hear me all right? Good. I'm Ben, as he said, and I work in Professor Lu Li's group. I'm going to talk about searching for new types of matter. In particular, I'm going to talk about something called a topological insulator, and I'll talk a little bit more about what that means. First, I want to pose you guys with a little puzzle to think about. I have here my breakfast. Okay, same breakfast most of you guys had. And I have my coffee mug, which is on the slide, and my donut. So I want you to think about, how is this donut the same as this coffee mug? Okay, they actually are the same in a certain way, and we'll talk about that in later in the talk. To make it even more puzzling, if I were to, you know, eat my breakfast, which I haven't yet, because I've been so excited about this little demo here. Yeah. Now, how is the donut no longer like the coffee mug, but now, how's the donut like the plate that sits on? So I'll let you guys ponder that. I'm going to eat more of my breakfast as the talk goes on, probably. And we'll kind of talk. I'll answer the question eventually, but you should still think about it yourself. Okay, so first, before I say what new types of matter we're looking for, I'm going to talk about how do we categorize matter? So what does it mean to have a new type of matter? So a familiar way to categorize matter is by its physical state. So you're all familiar with solids, liquids, and gases. This is one way that we can categorize matter. I have a picture here of liquid, water, ice, solid water, air, various types of physical states of matter. We can also categorize matter by its magnetic properties. So many people are familiar with permanent magnets. So here's a picture of a bar magnet with some iron filings that line up with the magnetic field. And other materials are not magnetic at all. So this is different ways we can categorize by magnetic properties. We can also categorize matter by their electrical properties. Some materials are conductors, other materials are insulators, and there's various other things that are totally different than those that I'll discuss, and some are in between. This talk will focus on this way of categorizing matter. In particular, I want to introduce this really new type of matter that's been recently discovered called a topological insulator. Okay, so first a little bit of review of what electrical properties are. Let's talk about conductors and insulators. An insulator is something that cannot allow electricity to move through it. So if I had this little circuit here and I had my rubber ducky plugged into the circuit, the light bulb would not turn on because rubber is an insulator and electrons are not allowed to flow through it. So the light bulb will stay off, but if instead I put a piece of metal there, a screw, electrons can move through that, that's a conductor, and the light bulb turns on. Hopefully he doesn't walk away. I think in practice he will stay put, but you know, shine brighter. So what else is there other than insulators and conductors? Those are pretty familiar, right? First, there's something called a semiconductor. These were first seen in the 1800s, so pretty long time ago, but they're still actively researched. And their fascinating property that's unique is we can control how well they conduct electricity. There's different things we can do to them that allow them to act more like a conductor or more like an insulator. And believe it or not, I'm fairly confident that everyone in the audience has a semiconductor with them here today because they're all in our cell phones. Okay? Semiconductors are the building blocks of all modern computer electronics. They're in your cell phone, they're in your computer at home, or the computer at the library if you don't have a computer at home for some reason. So other types of, so that's a semiconductor. There's also things called superconductors. That sounds pretty exciting, pretty super, right? These were first seen in 1911, so this was 100 years ago, still fairly old, but 100 years more recent than the semiconductor. Their exotic property is that they can conduct electricity without any resistance. So when electrons move through a regular conductor, conductors heat up, and you lose energy to heat into the surroundings. But in a superconductor, there's nothing impeding the flow of electrons through the material, so you can transfer energy without losing energy to heat and other things like that. And there's tons of applications for these. One very common one that you may be familiar with is making really powerful magnets. And these are used in the medical field to make MRIs, NMRs. These are all based on superconducting magnets. Also, you know, there's some attempts to use these for energy transfer. Already in some power plants, they have these superconducting lines to move energy from one side of the power plant to the other without losing a lot of that energy and costing them a lot of money. So there's still kind of challenges to put this in large scale, but this is another application for superconductors. Another application is levitating trains. So superconductors have a fascinating magnetic property that allows them to hover over a permanent magnet. And if you made a train out of this material, you could hover it over a magnetic track, and it could be pushed along the track with very low resistance. It's really kind of fascinating. There's cool videos online if you want to look them up. But I'll be talking about topological insulators. These were first seen in 2007. So this is very new physics, another 100 years after the superconductor was first seen. Their interesting property is they can conduct electricity only on the surface and not to the inside. So I have a little cartoon to explain this. So let's say this green block is a topological insulator, okay? And Mr. Electron comes in and he wants to get on the other side of that topological insulator. So first he wants to try to pass through the middle, but that is not allowed. Electrons cannot pass through the bulk of the topological insulator. But if instead you want to cross the surface, that is A-OK. All right? So electricity can move across the surface of a topological insulator, but not through the bulk. And there's various applications of this, including quantum computation and spintronics. I'm not going to go into any detail, basically, on these two things. But to motivate why these are important, you've noticed that your computers over the last decade have gotten a lot better. They're faster. They can have a lot more memory and hard drive space and all these things. Well, we're actually reaching the physical limitations pretty soon of how we can advance computers using current technology. So you can only, you know, make the components of a computer so small, because eventually you get down to atoms and you can't really go any smaller. These two quantum computation spintronics run on completely different principles than what current computers run on. So this is a way to push forward our computer technology when we kind of reach the end of what we can do with current semiconductor technology. So this is kind of important new research for keeping our science, our technology advancing. So SMB6 is an actual crystal that we study in our lab, and it's proposed to be a topological insulator. And here I have a picture of the crystal structure of SMB6. So these are a collection of atoms that make up this crystal. So SM is samarium. It's here on the periodic table, and that's this atom here. And in the middle are boron atoms, and these are boron atoms here on the periodic table. And below that crystal structure is an actual picture of the crystal that we are measuring in our lab. It's kind of black, shiny surface. And next to it, there's a plot of resistance versus temperature. So this plot was taken by a different group at the University of Michigan, but is of SMB6. And you notice that as it gets colder, as temperature goes down, the resistance goes up. This is something you'd expect from an insulator. As it gets colder, it doesn't allow electricity to pass through. But a normal insulator would look more like this. As it gets colder, the resistance will continue to rise and rise and rise until electrons can't pass through at all. But instead, we see this kind of saturation here at the top. So there's kind of a point where electrons are still allowed to pass through even though it gets really, really cold. And we believe that this is because electrons are still allowed to pass along the surface of the material even though they're not allowed to pass through the bulk. Okay, so before I talk about what a topological insulator is, I'm going to talk about what is topology. Don't be confused with topography. This has nothing to do with maps. It's actually a mathematical subject that studies shapes. So a sphere, we say, is topologically equivalent to a cube. And what that means is if you could take one shape and morph it into another shape without breaking it or gluing it to itself, those two shapes are topologically equivalent. So you can imagine if you had a sphere like the Earth, and you push in on the sides and push in on the top and bottom, and say it was made of Play-Doh, so it's just like really, you can mold it really easily. Then you can push it and turn it into a cube. Because I can do that without tearing the sphere apart, those things are topologically equivalent. In the same way, a coffee mug and a donut are topologically equivalent. So I said we'd come back to this. because I can take a coffee mug, let's say it was made of Play-Doh, kind of push it and mold it until it was a donut. So I have a little, I will actually do this for you with some little computer magic. All right, so I'm going to turn this coffee mug into a donut. Whew. Yeah, all right. So you can see it can turn into the donut without ever, I never have to break it. Because, but if I wanted to turn the coffee cup into a cube, I would have to break the handle. So you can think of it for these kind of shapes as how many holes does it have. So the coffee mug has one hole right here. There's no hole here because if I had a hole there and I put my coffee in the mug, it would fall right through and that would make a very inefficient coffee mug. So it has one hole. But let's say the donut, say I take a bite out of the donut, now it has no holes. I can now morph the donut into the plate. Does that make sense? All right. So that is kind of, it's a study of morphing one object to the other without ever having to break it. So what the heck does this have to do with physics? So what's topological about topological insulators? So let's imagine the green block, again, is a topological insulator, and the blue block is a normal insulator, okay? If we look at the quantum mechanics of these materials, there's a certain quantum property of the electrons in the topological insulator that is much like a Möbius strip. And I'll talk about what a Möbius strip is in a second. But in a normal insulator, the same quantum property is more like a loop, okay? So I'm going to argue that these two objects are topologically different. And to do that, I have here with me, thanks to the wonderful demo people in Michigan, a Möbius strip. Okay, it's a big mess, and a normal loop. If I take this Möbius strip, one property of it is it has only one side, okay, whereas the loop has two distinct sides. If I was on the inside of the loop and drawing a line, I would never have any marker on the outside of the loop. There's no way to go without picking up my marker and putting it on the other side, because there's two sides to this. But if I had my Möbius strip and I have my marker, let's say I start here on my Möbius strip, and I start drawing a line on my Möbius strip. I can go and go and go, as long as my marker doesn't run out. And I can keep drawing a line, never picking up the marker. Do-do-do-do-do, it's taking longer than I expected. And then I kind of get back to where I started. I never picked it up, and you can see that there's red marker on both the inside and the outside. Inside and outside. There is no inside and outside, right? So this is kind of a loop with a twist in it. Now, no matter what I do to this, I can kind of twist it around and play with it. I can't turn it into this loop. The only way I can turn this object into this object is by tearing it, taking the twist out, and reattaching it to itself. All right. So now, oh no, I didn't take the loop out. Whew. All right. Now it's no longer a Möbius strip, but it's a normal loop. And the only way I could have turned this object in the Möbius strip into the loop is by tearing it and reattaching. And even though, you know, you could say like, oh, they look like they have the same number of holes, but it's really a study of can I morph one object into the other without breaking it. And you can see that the only way to turn a Möbius strip into a loop is by breaking it, as long as you reattach it correctly. Okay, so now, the quantum property inside these materials is like a Möbius strip or like a loop. And if I were to smoothly transition out of the topological insulator into the normal insulator, there's kind of a break in the topology, right? And so along the surface of this, I have to basically tear this quantum property and re-glue it back to itself. And this allows there to be surface states or conducting electrons along the surface of a topological insulator, but only along the surface. That conductance comes out of this breaking in the topology. Okay, so to study these quantum properties, we have to go to really extreme environments. So in particular in our lab, we go to really, really cold temperatures, so really amazingly powerful refrigerators, and really high magnetic fields. So here I have a picture, this cylinder, this is Oxford on it, is a machine in our lab here at Michigan. And this thing is a refrigerator and a magnet all built into one. So it has a magnetic field that's 8 Teslas. So a Tesla is a measurement of magnetic field. And to get a sense of that, that is 1,600 times stronger than the magnets that you put on your refrigerator. So this is a really, really powerful magnet. And it also has a base temperature of 0.01 Kelvin. Okay, Kelvin is measurement temperature, and you might be like, ah, what the heck does that mean? Well, I'll talk about it. Sense of temperature. So what is a Kelvin? Kelvin's a measurement of temperature. Let's compare it to some numbers we know. The coldest day in Ann Arbor this winter. This was a really cold winter, and I'm from Texas, so it was really, really cold for me. I'll throw you a bone. With the wind chill, all right? Now, that was pretty cold. There's no way that this machine is colder than that. That was 234 Kelvin. That's really hot compared to this machine, right? Minus 38 degrees Fahrenheit is what my nice little iPhone app told me it was. The cold day, I took a screenshot, sent it to my family in Texas, be like, ha, why is this like this? But the base temperature of this machine is less than 1 Kelvin, a lot colder than Ann Arbor. The temperature where nitrogen turns into a liquid, now most of the atmosphere, the air, is made of nitrogen, so this is effectively the temperature when the atmosphere will turn into a lake, right? That has to be really cold when that happens. Surely it's colder than my machine. Of course, you know it's not, because I wouldn't have showed it if it was. 77 Kelvin. All right, that's still quite a bit hotter than our machines here. So our machine's less than a Kelvin. Minus 321 degrees Fahrenheit is when the air you're breathing will turn into Lake Michigan. So that's very cold. We also use this facility at the National High Magnetic Field Laboratory in Tallahassee. So this is a picture of a magnet there. We're actually going there at the end of April, beginning of May, to take some data. This magnet is the most powerful constant field magnet in the world, and we at Michigan get to use it. It's very exciting. This is a 45 Tesla magnet. Let's get an idea what that is. That's 9,000 times stronger than the magnets on your refrigerator. And that is 1,500,000 times stronger than the Earth's magnetic field. This is a ridiculous magnet. It's super cool. Okay? All right. So let's talk about our actual measurement. So what we do is we take our sample and we glue it on top of a little diving board. When I say little, I mean very little. So up here I have some pictures of our actual diving boards that we make in our lab. The top one is sitting on a penny, and the bottom one there is sitting on the head of a dime. So they're very, very tiny. And so I have this little schematic, and that gray block there is our sample sitting on the diving board. And then we put this diving board in a really big magnetic field and see how the sample pushes on the diving board in the magnetic field. Now, SMB6 is not a permanent magnet, so you may wonder, how is it that it would do anything? So I have a little demonstration to show. If I can remember how this works. Yeah, it worked. Cool. All right. So I have here some washers. I'm going to take this magnet out of the picture for a second. Okay, so these washers here are not magnetic, so I can... They don't stick to each other, you know, whatever. They're just normal little metal washers. They don't have that magnetic property of permanent magnet. Here I have a permanent magnet, all right, in the picture. It looks like, you know, a cartoon magnet. It's a horseshoe. Prove it's a magnet. I can put a little compass needle next to it, and the compass needle will point at the pole. I guess you can't see it in the picture, but if you look down here. And if I put it on the other side, you can see the other side of the compass points at the magnet. And if I flick it, it kind of keeps pointing at the magnet, so this is really a magnet. And then if I take these non-magnetic washers and I put them above the magnet, you can see now they stick to each other. Ah! Sorry, it's a really powerful magnet. They stick to each other. So these things that are not magnetic have this magnetic property when you put it in the magnetic field. And I can even stack them. A lot of materials are like this that develop magnetic properties when they're put in a magnetic field. Now, to prove that these things are really not magnetic, I didn't change the washers. If I take the magnet out of the picture, they lose their magnetic property. All right, that's pretty cool. All right, let's go. All right, in the same way, our sample, when I put it in the magnetic field, develops some sort of magnetic property. What we can do is we can put a magnetic field to our sample, and if the electrons in the sample are allowed to move in the plane perpendicular to the field, what we'll measure is kind of a wiggle in the diving board. So I have a little cartoon to show this. So if I send a magnetic field this way, the electrons allowed to move in the plane perpendicular to that, then the diving board will kind of wiggle up and down. And since the electrons are bound to the surface, or not bound to the surface, since they're only allowed to move on the surface, they can move along that surface perpendicular to the field. But if I instead put the magnetic field this direction, since electrons can only move on the surface, they can't move into the topological insulator. So they're not allowed to move in the plane perpendicular to that field. So we will not measure any wiggle in the diving board when I put the magnetic field in that direction. All right, so let's talk about our actual, what we see. So I have this plot here of these blue and white triangles. Those are just two different samples. And I have it, the x-axis here is angle. So this is at the magnetic field at a certain angle with respect to our crystal. Every time there's a triangle, that means we measure a wiggle in our diving board. So you see here, at 0 degrees, that's when the magnetic field, so that's a picture of our sample there, and below is a little cartoon of the side of the sample. So that's when the magnetic field is going like into the page of the screen, into the screen, or up from the side, and the electrons are allowed to move on that surface perpendicular to that that arrow. And you see we measure a triangle there at 0 degrees. But if I move over 90 degrees and put the magnetic field in this direction, the electrons cannot move in that plane perpendicular to that arrow because they can only move along that surface. And you see there's no triangle there at 90 degrees. So this experiment showed that we are only measuring electrons moving along the surface of the material, but we do not see it moving into inside of the material. So this our research shows that SMB6 does have conductance only on the surface and not in the inside. This is supporting the idea that it is a topological insulator. So to kind of summarize the main points here, topological insulators are a completely new type of matter that's very recently discovered, and they have applications, potential applications, to push the limits of our modern computing technology. So the interesting feature about them is that they can only conduct electricity along the surface. Electrons can only move around the surface, but not through the inside. And we measure in our SMB6 sample that electrons are only moving along the surface and not through the inside. And this supports the idea that we have actually a new topological insulator, which is very exciting. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Jenna Walrath, and I work for Professor Rachel Goldman. And today I'm going to tell you about my research on thermoelectric materials. So these are materials that can directly convert heat to electricity without any moving parts. So this is a sort of an energy application device, so I'm going to start with an energy slide. So this is the energy usage in the United States in 2012. So on the left is all of the ways that we produced energy, so from solar all the way down to our fossil fuels. Petroleum is the largest, of course. Then in the middle are all the ways we use that energy. So residential, in your homes, commercial, industrial, and then transportation. And then on the right here is what happened to that energy after we used it. So this blue box is good. This is the useful energy. This is the energy that did what we wanted it to. It went, you know, it's what's powering this computer, this projector. What moves your cars forward, this is good. But you see I've got this red box here, and it looks pretty big. And that's bad, because 60% of all this energy is wasted. And that is a really, really shocking number. I couldn't believe that the first time I heard that. But there's a lot going on here, and so I can't explain why so much energy is wasted on all of these, because there's a lot of details. So let's just focus on transportation. Let's try to relate this to something you deal with every day. So, gas prices, you know, are not great. So let's say that you pay $50 to fill up your tank of gas. So how much of that actually moves your car forward? So we're going to take a little quiz. I promise it's the only one. So raise your hand if you think that more than $35 goes towards moving your car forward. Okay, how about 25 to 35? Okay, don't be shy. 15 to 25. Okay, that's a really good, big response. All right, how about 5 to 15? Okay, well, unfortunately, it's the last group, that's right. so as little as $5 goes towards moving your car forward. And that also was another number that shocked me the first time I heard it. You know, I mean, they invented these things 100 years ago. Why is it just eating all of my money? And, you know, I'm a graduate student. I get paid in a graduate student stipend. So I would like somebody to blame for this because it makes me kind of angry. But unfortunately, most of the blame actually just goes to thermodynamics. So second law of thermodynamics is so important, even Homer Simpson enforces this rule in his own home. So the same reason that you can't have a perpetual motion machine, same reason why plugging the power strip in doesn't give you infinite power, besides common sense, is the second law of thermodynamics, which says that if I want to create an engine to do work, to do something useful, it can't be 100% efficient. I can never get that $50 all the way back because the universe requires some sort of sacrifice of that energy to the entropy of the universe. Okay, but, so we can't do $50, but we can do better than five, okay? So how are we improving this? So the car companies are actually doing a lot. This is just kind of a snapshot of some of the different ways you can recover some of this energy. So they're building better engines. They're putting solar panels on cars. This one in the bottom left, Mercedes made this concept car where they designed it based on a fish that had a really low drag coefficient. So this is like a really aerodynamic design to reduce the amount of energy used to friction. And then there's this other method, which is what I'm going to focus on, which is thermoelectric waste heat recovery. So your car is spitting out a lot of this energy just into heat. You know, your car is a great heater of the atmosphere. So what you can do is you can take a thermoelectric module, put it on your exhaust, and recover some of this energy by channeling it back into electrical energy to power the electrical systems in your car. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first introduce, you know, what is a thermoelectric material? How does it work? How do I make a generator out of it? And then I'll talk a little bit about some of the other ways you can use it, and then I will introduce my own research in studying them to make them more efficient. So first of all, what is a thermoelectric material? So as I said, it converts heat to electricity, or the other way around, actually. So what you do is you take a certain type of material that has charges that can flow. In this case, my picture is electrons. And then if I apply a temperature difference, so if I heat up one side, my charges will flow from hot to cold. And then I'll develop a voltage. So the charges are just moving from the energy gradient to hot to cold, unlike people who would like to move from cold to warm. Like Ben, I also grew up in Texas, so I really wanted to move back to the warm area this winter. But charges will just move according to the energy gradient. They always want to move from hot to cold. And then because these are electrical charges, it's building up a voltage. And this voltage is proportional to how much temperature difference I've applied. And that proportionality factor is this term called the thermal power that I'm going to use a few times. So I'm getting a voltage out of this, so it's kind of like a battery. But then the next question you might ask is, does this work with all materials, right? Can I do this with anything? And the answer is no. And I could write down a bunch of equations that tell you what types of materials are thermoelectrics, but I'm an experimentalist, so I'd rather just do a test. So we're going to do a little experiment, and I'm going to test a couple of materials to see what is a thermoelectric and what isn't. So I'll leave my slide up there. So what I'm going to do here is I have a voltmeter, and I'm going to heat up one of these probes to induce a temperature gradient in my sample, and then I'm going to measure the voltage to determine whether the material is really a thermoelectric or not. So I've got my flame there. So before I do this test, I'm just going to show you, sort of explaining what a voltage is. So this is a 9-volt battery. So if I put these leads on the electrodes of the battery, I see it's about 9 volts. So this battery is good, it works. And so while both probes are cold, I have a piece of aluminum. This is aluminum. This is gallium arsenide. So aluminum is a metal. Gallium arsenide is a semiconductor. So right now, when both probes are cold, if I touch them, my voltage is just zero. So nothing's happening. So now I'm going to heat up one of my probes, and then when I touch it to the material, it's inducing a temperature gradient and reading the voltage at the same time. So let's see what happens. So I'm going to heat this up here. This is a nice blue flame, so it's really hot. All right, so let's touch the aluminum. Okay, nothing happened. So it's probably not a thermoelectric. So let's try the gallium arsenide. Ooh, okay, I broke it, but look at that. That's a voltage. So what happened is when I touched the probe to the gallium arsenide, the charges flowed. And so that means gallium arsenide is thermoelectric, semiconductor is thermoelectric, but not the metal. So why is that? So I'm going to go back to my slide here and we'll talk about it. So you would think that the metal should have worked because, as Ben talked about, metals can conduct electricity really well. So if what I'm talking about is charges flowing, it seems like it should have worked. But the problem is it conducts too well, so it also conducts all my heat away. So I can't sustain a temperature gradient. And it also turns out that semiconductors are much better because they have this higher thermal power. So for a given temperature gradient, I can get a higher voltage than a metal no matter what, even if I'd come up with a way to sustain the temperature gradient. And semiconductors are also really nice because, as Ben mentioned, you can kind of tune their electrical properties. So they're really interesting to work with. But how do I go about actually making a device out of these? So this is using a property, it's called the Seebeck effect. So this guy, Thomas Seebeck, first is basically the father of thermoelectrics in a lot of ways, all the way back in 1821. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take two different semiconductors, one that has negative charges, one that has positive charges. I'm going to put them together, and I'm going to heat up one side and make the charges flow. So I'm basically making a battery out of this, but it's better than battery because batteries run out. Thermoelectrics don't, because I'm just using the intrinsic charges that are already in them. So how this works is I heat up one side, my charges flow from hot to cold, and I get a voltage, which can power something. I can also do sort of the opposite, which is make a Peltier cooler. So this little trick was discovered a little bit later by Jean Peltier. And what I can do is just the reverse. I can apply a current, and I can get a temperature difference. So I can make a cooler, I can reject heat from the system. So how this works is instead of applying a temperature gradient, I'm going to put a battery in here. And then I'm going to force the current to flow so I can reject the heat from my system. So I'm actually going to prove to you that these work. So I'm going to go back over to my little demo here and show you one more thing. So I have actually here a thermoelectric generator, courtesy of my advisor. You can actually get these on Amazon for like $15 if you want to play with them. So I've got two sides here. All right, and so I can apply a temperature gradient to one of the sides. So I'm going to connect this up to my voltmeter. And so it's reading pretty much zero voltage right now. But I'm going to apply a temperature gradient just with my hand, so just with the warmth of my body here. And there it goes. So that was pretty easy. And it works immediately. And then you see this was a negative number. Because current is flowing one way, and now if I flip it over and heat up the other side, I can actually make current flow the other way. And now it's positive. So this works really well, actually. And the nice thing about thermoelectric generators is this kind of looks like a black box. I'm not really showing you what's in there. But if you break this open, and you take, I'm going to try to let you see this in here. But what's in here is a bunch of stacks of pillars, just like what I have drawn up on the slide. So it's a bunch of pairs of positive and negative charge-carrying semiconductors that are connected together. So a bunch of these two sets are connected together in series so that they add up to give a large voltage that you can use to power things. So that works really, really well, actually. But you can use them for a lot of things. So let's talk a little bit about that. All right. So the main thing, as I mentioned, is that didn't work right. Let's go back to this one. Okay. So you can just take one of these generators and then take anything that produces waste heat, which, by the way, is everything. And you can take some of this waste heat and turn it back into electricity. And there are a lot of products actually already on the market that use these. So you can buy camping stoves that use thermoelectrics. There are these proposed combined heat and power systems for houses that use thermoelectrics. This is a product that some MIT grad students just came out with. It's basically a personal cooler that uses a Peltier cooler. And then NASA has used these for decades. So when you get really far from the sun, solar power isn't very reliable, and batteries will run out eventually. But as I said, thermoelectrics don't, so they're a great choice for space. So on the right here is a list of missions that NASA has used thermoelectric power on, and this is a picture of the Mars Curiosity rover, which has thermoelectric power sources. But I started this off talking about cars, so let's go back to talking about cars for a second. So how do I use these on cars? Well, as I mentioned, your exhaust gets pretty hot. This is a nice figure showing some of those temperatures. So see, it's all the way up to almost 800 degrees Celsius, which is a lot, actually. So if you put a thermoelectric module on part of the exhaust, one half is cooled by the exhaust, one half is cooled by the air, and this is going to generate electricity that you can feed back into your systems to improve your efficiency. There's actually another way that you can use thermoelectrics in cars. So this is a ventilated climate-controlled seat by a company called Amaragon. I think these were rolled out by Nissan, actually, a few years ago, and so you might start seeing more of them. But what it does is it's the sort of this personal cooler idea. So instead of spending a lot of energy to cool your car with your air conditioning, you can just cool yourself with a Peltier cooler in your seat. So the bottom line is you can, in the short term, like maybe in the next 5 years, you're probably going to be seeing a lot more thermoelectric modules in cars. And their goal, the industry goal, is like a 5 to 10% improvement in fuel economy in the short term. Longer term, if we get better efficiency, you can push this up to maybe 15 to 20% with these combined systems. And the bottom line is you can get maybe $2 all the way up to $9 back from that $50 tank of gas. And that actually is a lot of money if you add it all up. But there's kind of a caveat hidden in the slide here that I've slipped by you, and that's this term that says with better efficiency. So it turns out it's kind of a problem. Thermoelectrics are tricky. So changing one parameter pretty much changes everything, so you get this sort of balancing act. So what I want is I want high electrical conductivity, I want my charges to flow, but I want a relatively low thermal conductivity so I can sustain my temperature gradient. But I want a high thermal power because I want to apply 1 degree Kelvin and get a lot of voltage out of it as much as possible. And all of those things will lead to a better efficiency. So my green arrows are all good things, and this means this is a happy graduate student working on thermoelectrics. Okay? So let's say this graduate student has this material and they want to make it better. So they're like, okay, let's increase my electrical conductivity of the sample. Okay? But then probably what the graduate student is going to find is that this decreases your thermal power because these two parameters tend to be inversely related in general, which is a bummer. And you're also going to increase your thermal conductivity because you're making the electrons flow better. You're probably also going to make the heat flow better. So this means lower efficiency, which means a sad graduate student. but the graduate students, we don't give up very easily. So the graduate student is like, okay, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna increase my thermal power. I'm gonna go from this angle. Well, okay, you probably are gonna kill your electrical conductivity, as I said before. But you know, the graduate student's like, okay, but by doing that, I can increase my thermal conductivity. Maybe this will work. But usually, what happens is the mechanisms by which you increase your thermal power kill your electrical conductivity so much that maybe you broke even, and maybe you even lost. So it's really hard. And so this is my sad graduate student again, and maybe by this point it's my mad graduate student, as the madness is sort of setting in, because this graduate student has realized that this little seesaw picture I've included here is not very accurate, a descriptor of the problem. It's maybe more like this, on a moving train. but just because it's hard doesn't mean it's impossible, and like I said, we don't give up easily. So There are a lot of people working on this efficiency problem at all levels, actually. So this is sort of a snapshot of thermoelectric technology development, all the way from the physics end to engineering. So engineers are actually putting these together, trying to match materials, properties, and making modules that aren't going to break, that are going to stand up to high temperatures and still be efficient. But then I'm down here in the physics to material science range. So I'm working on things at the nanometer scale, at the atomic scale, sort of the molecular scale. And the reason why I'm down here is because it turns out that a lot of ways you can increase efficiency by trying to get around these interrelated properties is by nanostructuring. So designing materials at the atomic and molecular levels to say, okay, well, if I want, electrons to flow and not heat, maybe I can put in some little barriers into my material at the nanometer scale that will let electrons flow but block my heat, for example. So there's a lot of really interesting work going on at this level. But this is a really small scale, and most measurements are, on the scale of maybe millimeters down towards the other end. And that's kind of a problem because you really want good techniques to measure things at the scale you're engineering them on. So that's what I do. So I use a technique called scanning thermoelectric microscopy, which is basically the exact same thing as the multimeter experiment I just did, except what I do is I heat up my sample, and then I have a metal tip which I touch to the sample, which induces a temperature gradient, just like my probe induced a temperature gradient in the sample when I did the demo. But and then what I do is just, again, I basically have a voltmeter, just like the multimeter that measures the voltage between these two, and then I can determine for a given temperature gradient, how much voltage am I getting out? And that tells me a lot about the electrical properties at the nanoscale. So the difference is, the reason I'm able to do this at the nanoscale is because my tip is way smaller than my multimeter probe. So this is a picture of one of our tips, actually, compared to a human hair. So human hair is about 20 microns across, and my tip is a lot smaller than that. So this is a picture of me holding, that's a sample plate with one of our samples in it, and then on the bottom is a tip holder, so that little metal stick you can barely see sticking out is my tip, and the end of that is so small, it's the end of the tip is nanometers. So I'm directly measuring thermoelectric properties on a nanometer scale, and my group, the Goldman group, is one of only three groups in the entire world using technique like this right now, so it's very new and very, very interesting. So with that, I'll wrap up here. And as a summary, is that thermoelectric materials can directly convert heat to electricity, which can save you money. But achieving high efficiency is hard, because changing one parameter changes everything. But I use scanning thermoelectric microscopy, which can measure these properties on a nanometer scale to understand better how we can engineer these to have better efficiency. So I want to thank my group, who I've shown here, along with my advisor. So thank you very much.
All right, good morning. I'm Tim, and I am from Minnesota, so I don't know what the big deal was this winter. Anyway, so you've heard two very experimental talks so far, and I'm going to take a little bit different direction now and talk about a more theoretical side of things. And hopefully by the end of the talk, you'll be able to understand what these pictures at the top are. So you've heard two talks, like I said, about experiments, and they're both about experiments on the molecular and atomic scale. My talk is going to be about something much smaller. So if we zoom in very, very far on one of those atoms in the molecule, you'll find this thing called the nucleus of the atom, which is made up of particles called protons and neutrons. And the structure of the nucleus can tell you a lot about the atomic and nuclear physics that go on. But actually, I want to go even deeper. If we zoom in much further on the proton itself, we find that there's a whole bunch of interesting physics inside there. So here you can see things called quarks, like up quarks marked with a U or down quarks with a D. The proton has three main quarks, which are two ups and a down, and they give it its electric charge. But there's also this whole soup of other particles that are kind of popping into and out of existence thanks to quantum mechanics. And so there's other quarks, like Ds and charm quarks with a C. There's also the strong force carriers called gluons. Those are marked with Gs here. And these are the things that sort of hold the quarks together, the glue. And all of these are part of the big picture of the fundamental particles and forces that make up our universe. And so these purple ones are the quarks that are inside the protons and neutrons. And the electron is marked with an E there. That's one of the types of leptons. And then we have force carriers in red. So the photon you might be familiar with, it's the particle of light. It's from electromagnetism. And those gluons that I mentioned that hold quarks together. And also, you've probably heard a lot in the news recently over the last few years about this new Higgs boson, which was discovered at CERN in Switzerland. And that's a very big deal. Last week, I think you heard an interesting talk from David Kaplan about this, and he gave a lot of the history about how we came to understand this picture of the universe. But an interesting bit of trivia that I didn't hear from his talk was where the name quark came from. Actually, it was not coined by a physicist, and that sounds like something a physicist might say. It was, in fact, part of a James Joyce book from Finnegan's Wake. So Murray Gell-Mann, one of the people who originally discovered what we call the Standard Model of Particle Physics, he was thinking about trying to name these new particles that he had been thinking about. These, at the time, they knew about three of the quarks, the up, the down, and the strange quark. And so these three quarks, three particles at the time, he didn't know what to call them. So it happened that he was paging through Finnegan's Wake, and he came across this line, three quarks for Muster Mark. Sure he has not got much of a bark, and sure any he has, it's all beside the mark. And he thought, that's it, three quarks. That's what we'll call them. And somehow we discovered three more quarks, and that's still what they're called. But that's where it came from. Anyway, how do we study things at this very, very small scale, inside the proton? To do that, we have to go to extremely high energies. So I have here a little animation from the ATLAS experiment at CERN. And you're looking at one of the protons that they accelerate. And inside, you can see the three quarks. So they accelerate these protons in giant tunnels. At the Large Hadron Collider, it's enormous. And it gets up to speeds very near the speed of light, so extremely high energies. And then inside these big giant detectors, they smash the particles together. And this whole spray of other stuff comes out. And they measure what comes out. And that can tell them a lot about the physics. And of course, I don't have the finances or the room to put one of these big accelerators inside this lecture hall. They're like 27 kilometers in diameter. And even the detector itself would not fit here. But I do want to do an experiment that's similar. So let's do an experiment. I brought with me today two Lego protons. And we're going to collide them. But as a theorist, I never get to dress up in all this fun gear, so let me get all safe. So what we expect is just like the last slide. We're going to smash these particles together, and we're going to get a spray of things coming out. And we're going to learn some physics from that. All right, so here we go. Proton number one gets up near the speed of light. Proton number two is up near the speed of light. And I should warn the front two rows, you may be in the splash zone. So here we go. Awesome. All right, so that was fun. But what can we learn from that? Well, we can take a ruler and we can measure how far did these things go. We got Legos all over the place. And we can measure, say, what angle did they come flying out at. Don't worry, you can leave them. I'll clean them up later. And we can measure what size particles came out. And all of these things can tell us a lot of information about what those Lego protons were originally before we smashed them. And if we repeat this experiment many times, we can get some probabilities, like what's the probability of finding yellow Legos in the front row of seats. All this together tells us something called the scattering cross-section for this interaction. It's essentially telling us the probability of certain interactions occurring. And a bigger cross-section means that this interaction is more likely. So there is a very large cross-section for making a mess when you collide Legos. This cross-section also depends a lot on which type of particles are involved. So depending on, say, quarks versus gluons, or blue versus yellow Legos. And so to do an example here, if we have two protons coming in, suppose two of their quarks collide. And then the cross-section is essentially a black box that tells you there's a certain probability that you'll measure in the experiment a couple of quarks and maybe some electrons and positrons. That happens with a certain probability. We can do this experiment again, take some more identical protons, this time suppose two gluons interact. Well, there's a different cross-section for this interaction, and it tells you there's some probability that you'll measure three gluons coming out. And as an experimentalist, you go, you do this many, many times, millions and millions of times, and eventually, even though the cross-section is essentially a black box as far as the experiment is concerned, you can build up a picture of what might be inside that box. But as a theorist, I want to say, well, what did we expect the box to look like? Can we predict what we'll see inside? And to do that, we need to study something called the scattering amplitude. So what is that? Well, quantum mechanics tells us we should treat these protons and particles as waves. And a wave has a certain amplitude. That's the height of the wave. Here, I've called it psi. Quantum mechanics also tells us that the probability of measuring a particle is proportional to the square of the amplitude. Well, when many particles interact, many waves interact, their waves overlap, and we get something called the scattering amplitude for this interaction. So that's A. And what I just said on the last slide is that probability of some interaction is the cross-section. And so quantum mechanics basically tells us the cross-section is related to the square of the scattering amplitude. And it happens that from the theoretical side, it's much easier to study the amplitude than to study the cross-section. So that's what we'll talk about. There's many ways to compute the amplitude from the theory. One way is discovered by this dapper young man, Richard Feynman. And he actually received a Nobel Prize for his work related to understanding quantum field theory and his Feynman diagrams. And this is what I'll call the old way to compute them. But how do we do that? These Feynman diagrams are built from two basic vertices in the case of gluons. So we have a, say, three gluon vertex, where, for example, two gluons can fuse into one. There's also a four gluon vertex. Three gluons come in and go to one. And by mixing and matching these vertices, we can draw all the different ways of these gluons interacting by gluing together legs on these two basic vertices. Now, I should mention that these are nice squiggly pictures, but they actually do have a real mathematical meaning. This is a convenient way of representing some actually fairly complicated mathematics. And don't worry, Jenna was the only one with a quiz. I won't test you on this. But this sort of gives you a dictionary for how to translate from these nice, pretty Feynman pictures to a real mathematical expression. So let's actually draw some of these diagrams. I said we have these two basic vertices. So let's say we want to study the type of interaction, one of the animations that I showed of two gluons come in, three gluons come out. How can we connect these diagrams to make an interaction like that? Well, one way is to glue together two of the legs, one from the three vertex and one from the four vertex. And you can see now, reading from left to right, two gluons come in, three gluons come out. Of course, there's another way we could have done that, by gluing together different legs. Or we can even do it using only three gluon vertices. In fact, there are 10 different ways you can have two gluons go to three in this example. So you can see already this is getting fairly complicated. By the time you get up to a total of 10 particles, so like two going to eight, you can see there are 13,000 diagrams you'd have to draw in order to describe this interaction. And I don't know, even the most brutal quantum field theory professor would not put that on a problem set. Okay, so this is computationally a challenge, as you can see. But there's also another side of the story, which is kind of challenging and a little bit surprising. After you add up all of the mathematical expressions that correspond to these diagrams, you can do some simplification and some crazy manipulation, and you find actually a very simple answer. And that's kind of surprising, because you remember from the last slide, those were rather complicated looking expressions, mathematical expressions, and somehow it all simplifies. To get a better idea of what that looks like, suppose I gave you this mess of puzzle pieces, and I said, you have a few minutes, put them together, and tell me, what shape does that make? Well, Probably it would not be obvious at first, and it might take you a little while of spinning and playing with these to discover, actually, this is just a circular disk. And these goofy shapes are kind of like the Feynman diagrams. You can add them all up, and it's not obvious, but they simplify to something nice and symmetric. On the other hand, suppose I had given you a bunch of circles. You can spin these around all you want. It's not going to change anything. And it probably wouldn't take very long to realize they fit together into a nice circular disk. So this leads us to the question, can we use some symmetries to tell us what building blocks to use to construct scattering amplitudes? So just like these puzzle pieces were Feynman diagrams, what is it that these circles would correspond to in physics? So our goal then is to look for these symmetric building blocks out of which to build the amplitude. And probably a good place to start is with the theory with the most symmetries you can write down in four dimensions. This is called N equals 4 Super-Yang-Mills theory, which is kind of a fun word to say, fun name to say. Anyway, this was actually is a very exciting area of research. And just very recently, a bunch of theoretical physicists and mathematicians from Princeton and Harvard and MIT, they came up with a nice way of studying this theory. They came up with nice symmetric building blocks over the amplitudes in this theory. These are called on-shell diagrams. They're kind of like Feynman diagrams, at least insofar as you can think about them as two gluons come in this case, and they mix around in the middle. And at the end of the day, three gluons come out. But these are much nicer than Feynman diagrams because they have a whole lot of extra mathematical structure. For one thing, they are like the circles from building the disk. They have a lot of symmetries. And OK, it doesn't look like it from this diagram. But if you look at the math expressions, they're actually very symmetric. They're also very nice computationally because you can build them recursively from just the two basic black and white vertices. So if you know all of the, say, 3 and 4 point interactions, you can get all of the 5 gluon diagrams pretty easily. Because of this computational convenience, actually, CERN has already started using a lot of the technology that was the math technology that was discovered while studying these types of questions. They already used this to study some background processes, and this was important, say, for discovering the Higgs, because we have to know what types of particles are going to appear in the background. These are also nice because there are a lot less of them than there are, a lot fewer of them than there are Feynman diagrams. So for instance, this is the 5 gluon type interaction. This diagram plus the corresponding one with the blacks and the whites flipped, that tells you all of the physical information about the gluons that was in those 10 Feynman diagrams from before. And you can see the number still grows, but much less quickly than with the Feynman diagrams. And this is very nice for doing, say, a homework set. I also want to include here just, these are nice pretty pictures, but they are actually mathematically rigorous. They have a mathematically rigorous foundation. And it's, in fact, the structure of these expressions that a lot of my research has been on. And so trying to understand how, for instance, these different amplitudes can be related to each other. And this is a question that's interesting not only for physics reasons, but also to mathematicians. I mentioned there were some mathematicians on that other paper. And together with one of the physicists, there's been already a very interesting discovery about these amplitudes in N equals 4 Super-Yang-Mills theory. They discovered that the amplitude might actually be computing the same thing as computing the volume or the area of a shape. So they call this shape that corresponds to the amplitude, they call it the amplitudehedron. Kind of a mouthful, but still very interesting. And it's you may have seen it actually appear in some science publications. For example, it's been called the jewel at the heart of quantum physics. And Discover magazine actually named this in January this year. They named it the number 10 discovery of 2013 in physics. They claim that this new amplitudehedron might shape the future of physics. OK, so it's a mouthful to say. But what is it actually doing? Well, suppose we want to compute the area of a shape. Well, there are some nice formulas for the area of a pentagon. It's kind of nice, actually. It's kind of gross. especially if you start squeezing and stretching some of these edges. This formula is only valid if this is a perfectly regular pentagon, all of its sides of equal length. On the other hand, you might remember from your high school geometry class that the area of a triangle is much easier to compute. No matter how you stretch it out or squish it, the area of a triangle is always 1/2 the base times the height. And fortunately for us, those of us interested in computing the area of a pentagon, you can actually break it up into a bunch of triangles. And then computing the area is just adding up the areas of the triangles. Now, what was surprising and what's very interesting is that each of these triangles corresponds to an on-shell diagram. And it happens that if you add up the areas of the triangles, it's the same as adding up these on-shell diagrams to get the amplitude. OK, that's neat. Why is that the case? Actually, we don't know. This is still an open question in physics and in mathematics. And people are really trying to understand how can this tell us a lot about the physics? This is leading us to some new interpretations of quantum field theory, and is very exciting. One practical thing that comes out of this is you could just as well have chosen some different triangles in the polygon, and those would correspond to different on-shell diagrams. But these are the same pentagon, and so the amplitudes are the same, even though the on-shell diagrams look different. Just like the triangles are different, but the polygon is the same. So this gives us some geometric interpretation of these relations between different representations of the same physical quantities. And so in terms of the cross-section of these probabilities, this is telling us actually that computing these probabilities of interaction, you can do it many different ways, but it's always computing the area or the volume of the same thing. And the last point I want to make is that for more gluons, you actually start looking at not just triangles, but higher dimensional generalizations of triangles. And surprisingly, perhaps, all of the mathematics stays the same. So this is very useful for studying, even in many higher dimensions, these types of questions. OK. With that, I'd like to wrap up. And I'll just review what we've covered today. So these scattering amplitudes, the probabilities, essentially, of computing these interactions, they can be computed many different ways. The old way was to use Feynman diagrams, but that was very complicated, and it hides a lot of the interesting mathematical structure. The new way is to use things like on-shell diagrams. These are nice symmetric building blocks to build the amplitude. And finally, there's this very surprising and interesting new result that geometry provides us with an interesting new interpretation of the amplitudes. And so this has been an interesting project to work on with people both in the physics department here at Michigan, as well as some mathematicians here that I've worked with. And they've been very nice. They try very hard to speak physics to us, which is helpful when talking to a mathematician. Anyway, the last thing I wanted to say is that all three of us, as Myron mentioned, are supported by National Science Foundation Graduate Research Fellowships. And so we're very grateful for that support throughout our academic careers. And I'm very thankful to all of you for coming to join us this morning and listen to our talks. So thank you very much.